अच्छा, एनी क्वेश्चंस प्लीज? यस
हजूर, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। प्लीज अलाउ मी टू स्पीक इन उर्दू। Because the question I have already written, and that is in Urdu. I can translate later. Hazur, Jamaat-e Ahmadiyya ki taraf se हर साल सीरतुल नबी सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम और पेशवान मज़हब पर हिंदुस्तान में जलसे हुआ करते थे, जिसमें गैर जमात मुसलमान और गैर मुस्लिम अहबाब कसरत से शिरकत फरमाते थे। मुझे इलम नहीं कि अब भी इंडिया में इस किस्म के जलसे नहीं। इस डायरी में जो के खुदामुल अहमदिया लंदन की तरफ से इस साल छपी है, जमात अहमदिया यूके के जलसों की तारीखें छपी हैं, इनमें पेशवाने मजाहब के जलसे का जिक्र नहीं, सिर्फ सीरतुल नबी सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम के जलसा का जिक्र है। अगर ऐसे जलसे मखलूके खुदा की भलाई के लिए और तबलीगी लिहाज से मुस्तफीद हैं, तो हजूर फरमाएं कि क्या उनका इजरा सारी दुनिया के लिए किया जा सकता है?
Your questions are always well prepared, eh?
Not always.
Generally, most often.
There are three half and three full white stripes on the Khudamul Ahmadiyya flag. What do they represent, Hazur?
Three
half on the right hand side and three full lines, white stripes.
I don't know exactly the significance.
You have
been the Sadr. Yes. While I was Sadr, even then I didn't know the significance. I admit it.
Secondly, there is a request to you. You have written in past many poems. Could we have the privilege to listen one of those poems in this session, please?
Which poems?
Any other poem other than the
Jalsa Salaam poem. Well, I'll see to it. I will see.
Please.
I don't rule it out, but I don't promise either. Anyone else? We are missing Choy Rishida Masala. No. Maksud,
please. फिनलैंड में बदफे आजी के दौरान हेलसिंकी में तातार मुस्लिम लीडर मिस्टर अब्दुल्ला से मुझे मिलने का इत्तेफाक हुआ। उसको एमडीए से बड़े प्रकाश है। जब उसको ये पता चला कि मैं एमडीए का नुमाइंदा हूँ, तो उसने मुझसे ये सवाल किया कि आप नार्वे में कब से काम कर रहे हैं। मैंने उसको ये जवाब दिया कि हमारा मिशन 1956 है। दूसरा उसका सवाल ये था कि आप लोगों ने कितने लोगों को कन्वर्ट किया है। मैंने कहा इस वक्त तो सिर्फ एक है। कहने लगा कि 30 साल के अरसा में अगर आप लोग एक ही आदमी को कन्वर्ट कर सके हैं, तो इसका मतलब ये है कि तुम लोग हक पर नहीं हो। और उसने मेरी कोई बात सुनने से इनकार कर दिया।
क्वेश्चन
इज दैट हाउ कैन वी सेटिस्फाई सच टाइप ऑफ पीपल।
यू कांट नॉट लव इट अनलेस यू प्रीच इफेक्टिवली। यू कांट सेटिस्फाई दैट। You can't take him to from Norway to some other country, for example, Nigeria instead, because they don't, they both begin with an N. The simple reason is, if somebody asks you about Norway, you should have to answer him regarding Norway. And this is exactly the state of affairs there. Unless you preach more seriously, and all the Ahmadis are involved, and you have larger conversion, you can't say that you can effectively defend your position. Please, go ahead.
दूसरा सवाल ये है, मैंने सुन के हमें एक कॉलेज ने इनवाइट किया, दुनिया के प्रोफेसर ने इनवाइट किया कि हमारी क्लास में आता हम लोग वहाँ गए। उस दिन वो लेक्चरर जो था वो बीमार था, इसलिए प्रोफेसर जो है वहाँ के प्रिंसिपल पर वो हमारे साथ क्लास में गए। और क्लास खत्म होने के बाद मैंने उसको इस्लाम के मुतालिक कुतुब हासिल किए, तो उसने ये कहकर कुतुब लेन से इनकार कर दिया कि तुम तकलीफी ग्रुप से हो, हमारी दिलचस्पी उस इस्लाम से है जो इराक में हो रहा है या जो ईरान में हो रहा है, उस वक़्त फ़लस्तीनियों को शाम वाले मार रहे हैं, और वो कह उसका ये था कि हमारे लिए वो दिलचस्पी का बायस है। तो ये इस किस्म के जो
You have a wide world open to you.
Sir,
why do you go to such people who always reject you? You have to be choosing yourself. Instead of believing that you give your trust to them, why don't you make your trust? If you are a farmer, your family is a Jat family, I know. If you have plenty of land available to you, and you have not means enough to cultivate all the land possessed by you, which one will you choose first? The color patches or the most fertile one? Tell me. If you have 100,000 acres of land, and you can only cultivate 10 acres of land, would you choose the worst of the available land or the best of the available land? So why choose the best land? Do you mean to say that the entire Norway and the entire Finland are not ready to listen to your message? If that is the inference, I can't agree with you, unfortunately. There are hundreds of thousands of people in both these countries. If properly approached, they would offer you sympathetic ears, or by working on them for a while, you can make them really, really truly interested. So that is my advice to you. Search for your own, search for your land, and be choosy about it. Don't waste your time.
We have got a number of success in this respect, but unfortunately that man, he has written this...
He's a political man. Why are you insisting on my telling you something about him? His answer tells me that he's a political man. His interest in Islam is entirely political. So you're going to the wrong man. Leave him alone.
Science discourages marriages between first cousins, yet Islam allows it. Is this a contradiction?
Science.
Yes. Well, I've heard it said many times from various sources. I'm a layman, so I'm not a medical person, but genetically they say...
Too many marriages in one family sometimes create problems and also produce some good results. This is inbreeding always results in these problems as well as advantages. The good points of our family genes are multiplied and they continue to add to each other. So are the bad points. So at certain occasions, there is a possibility of an offspring having inherited all the bad points in the exaggerated form. So they are the streak boys born or streak girls, you know, they are out of the normal, abnormal boys or subnormal boys. And there are cases when geniuses are also born in the same family because of this intermarriage. So science neither rejects nor accepts this. It has nothing to say on this issue from the religious point of view. It will only tell you the facts and it will leave the choice to you. And Islam doesn't say positively that you should go and marry only among your family. Only Islam permits and leaves it to your wisdom, your best judgment, what to do in what situation. Another hand was observed from behind. Yes. Siraj.
Sir, I
think
it's clinic.
You go away by him by processing. A few days ago I had it shown to his face self. Last night I answered this question in essence, not in exactly that question, but a question similar to this, which would suffice for you as well. You better listen to that tape, right? Any other question, please? Khokan Sahib, have you run out of your questions?
Yes, sir. No.
Yes,
no.
So why are you
giving permission yesterday?
What?
I had your permission yesterday to go on with the questions. I was waiting
for all of the questions. All right, well, after that boy, this young boy who wants to say something, please. Otherwise you didn't know him. It was only Allah who revealed himself to you. And when he revealed himself to you, he also told you that he was Allah. We know only that much. Name is required not by you yourself, but by someone else. For you yourself, you don't need a name. The name is only required for the person who knows you, or to whom you want to be known. So Allah only tells us of His name when He makes Himself known to us. And that is where our history begins of Allah. You understand? So before that we don't know, nobody has told us. So how can I answer that question? To many people before, because Allah is from eternity and He has been creating people, things from eternity. So that has been going on. People before us, maybe on this earth or somewhere else, were told by Allah that He was Allah. And so the people before them, somewhere else, in some planet, in some other universe maybe, in the previous births of the same universe maybe. So because He is eternal, we can conjecture that His name is also eternal. whenever he created, and an eternal being continues to create and always is in a process of creation. If he is a creator, that eternal being is. So because he never loses his attributes, this is our conjecture, that whether we can understand it or not, all his attributes have been put into effect ever since eternity, which means it has no other end. So that means his name Allah is eternal in that sense. I hope you understood this.
I'm asking you, I said, have you understood this or are you just got tired?
I have understood.
You have?
Thank you.
Very clever, aren't you?
Hazur, man is born without a fate.
Without a fate?
Without a faith. That faith is given to him either by his parents or by society.
Or a belief. That is what you say.
That's what I'm making a statement.
But that is not what other Muhammad Mustafa Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said. To be careful with what you say.
But I know that man is born with fitrat sahiya.
That's not all what he has said. Kullu mauludin yuladu ala al-islam. That is also other two episodes of tradition. Abawahu yuhawridani or yunasirani. It is his parents then, whether that is into a Christian or into a Jew, that is just for instance. So every man is born on Islam. That is the budget of Islam. That has to be the other tradition
is in fact in conformity with this one, because when he said kullu mauludin yuladu alal fitrate, that is one and the same thing, because the Holy Quran claims Islam to be deen e fitrat. So fitrat and Islam are one and the same thing. So if a mullah draws a corollary from some sayings of the Holy Quran which appears to be obnoxious to human nature and is contradictory to humanity as such, that should not be accepted by a Muslim, because Allah has created man in nature, that is, he is in total conformity with the act of God. And he is in peace with the entire nature around him. So anything which is against man's nature, which is created by Allah, could not have been said by the Holy Quran. That is one problem we can make, a safe problem. So from this explanation, after having heard this explanation, now you can frame your question, please.
A man becomes starch. His faith as he grows up.
Correct.
I'm given to understand, and I'm being told, and I'm being asked to be the superiority of my faith, I'm expressed. You know what? Superiority of my faith. That my faith is superior than others. Now, if I look back to the history, I do not think that my faith has made previous generations till today a better human being. So that means my faith has failed to take the humanity.
So why did you take your faith then?
Pardon?
When your faith has failed you, the natural result should be that you should take your faith.
That was my question of yesterday, sir. Which is faith?
That is my answer.
Is it the man who makes the faith?
Pardon?
It is the man behind the faith, or is the faith?
What I mean to say is, if your faith has deserted you, you better desert such a faith. That is a simple logical conclusion that you are drawing yourself to.
No, sir, I'm trying to reconcile myself to my beliefs. my belief is that my faith is still spiritual.
Despite the fact that when you look back at history,
yes,
up till now, you find that your faith has failed to produce,
yes,
what it claims to produce.
So, somewhere something is wrong, it's either me or my faith.
So, that is what I am telling you. In such a situation, if you are true to yourself, either don't believe in what you are believing, or reject that faith, which speaks of something else and does something else. The most important thing is for one to be honest. As I told you yesterday, or the day before, I don't remember, the most important thing to which the Holy Quran draws one's attention is this, that you have to be true. If you are true to yourself, even if you are not true in relation to the truth itself, you have an internal truth, still Allah will forgive you. But even if you are born in truth and you are not true to yourself, you will not be pardoned by Allah. You will be taken account of. You will be brought to books. So you have to be true to yourself. That is most important. If you find your faith to have failed in its claim and or is inconsistent, then you better desert that faith.
I'm asking this. The other guy, my neighbor was under my public, he is a white man, very big man. I was in
so why are you cheating the poor man?
I was in my garden, he came up rushing from inside his house.
Yes.
The paper. Just wearing this half feet, Mr. What happened to you? He said, look, this is your Islam. And he was showing me the photograph of Maulana Khomeini. I won't tell him Imam, Maulana Khomeini. This is your Islam. Now what do I have to tell him?
What did you say?
I said, no, this is not.
Yes,
I'm still better than being burned on the stake, you see. I told him this, that this is not my Islam.
So?
He was not convinced. He asked me, what is your Islam? Then I started explaining and he ran off. He said, no, I can't understand all that. Five times a day, your prayer and all that. He ran off. So what, that is the point, you see. Have we failed the faith, or faith has failed us?
Do you want me to run off?
I still can't understand the question part of it. Or it has not come yet, perhaps.
what I'm trying to bring you out, say, a fact, notice, or asking the reason why in the history we have not been able to produce.
History is action of men. History is not the judgment on faiths. History is action of men.
Exactly, sir. That is the only point which I am asking. History is judgment on faith or not?
History is action of men. If the action, it may become a judgment on faith or may not become. Directly, history has nothing to do with faith. It is a collection of action of men. If men are true to their faiths and have failed, then only and only then would history become a judgment, a history of judgment of faith. Otherwise not. History may vary from time to time, from nation to nation. There are people, and very seldom so, who are true to their faiths. Then, in all honesty, they have worked according to their views and beliefs and have failed. Such people will be presented by history as a people, of course, but indirectly, the history would also be giving judgment on their faith. That they did not fail their faith, yet their faith failed them. On the contrary, you may come across such people who had a faith, who rejected their faith in all practical values, in their life, in their pursuit of ideals, the faith lied in different direction and the ideals which they really pursued were lay in different directions. And they also failed. That history also would be the history of action of such men. But indirectly, through inference, you can say that history is passing judgment that their faith might have been good. But they never tried it. History won't say that faith was positively good, which was abundant, this is why they failed. History will only be neutral in this respect. That while they had not acted upon their faith, so we cannot reject and censure their faith. That will be the only verdict of history. There is a third possibility. A people are true to their faith and they act upon their faith and they succeed dramatically. They bring about fantastic revolutions. That history will also be a history of the action of the people, yet it will be directly bearing a witness, a testimony, that their faith was positively something highly productive and was on the right side, at least to the extent that faith helped those people to rise to great heights, while previously they had they were nothing in the world, in the Committee of Nations. For instance, the history of the Arabs, just prior to the time of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and during the time of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and a few hundred years after. That will be a history of the Arabs to begin with, but it will also show that those Arabs were transformed after accepting of faith and acting upon that. And the history of the later part of the same Arabs, or an enlarged Muslim empire, let's say, would give its verdict through the actions of the people who followed them, that when once they had decided or had inadvertently deserted their faith, then they began the downhill course, which is still observed. So, again, through their actions, an inference will be drawn that a faith which had once proved effective in bringing about great revolutions and changing the lot of a people, once deserted, it produced exactly the opposite effect. So there the entire credit would go to the faith and entire discredit would go to the people. So history can give you different verdicts. Initially and basically, it is the history of the activities of human beings. And these inferences can be drawn variously in various situations. Yes, please. After a very long, you have decided to ask a question, eh?
Huzoor, I am privileged to have your audience several times, and therefore I hesitate to take up your time here. According to the Islamic laws of inheritance, if I understand them correctly, only up to one-third of one's estate can be willed to other than the heirs. And out of that one-third, one cannot will anything to anyone of the heirs. Under modern conditions, when a wife survives a husband and the children are grown up, especially when they are living on their own, one finds that the widow is very reluctant to accept any help from the children, and her own share of the inheritance is normally very meager. Would it be permissible to make some provision so that the wife can continue to maintain a standard of living which would be in keeping with the assets or the estate that the person has left?
That union is already been provided. Room for such a provision is already provided. Under the system of dowry, you can can increase the dowry in such a case and in such a
rule. So dowry
money will in fact
for this very purpose, that if a woman is either divorced or is left helpless due to some calamity, then she must have something in her hand to give her sustenance. Now, if you fear, or somebody I mean fears, that if he leaves only that much property to his wife, as is legally permissible under Islam, and he also fears that the children are such that they would not look after their mother, or they will not take a position that will not take anything as long as you are alive. In such a case, a man should provide to such a wife under this dowry system, because it is not forbidden to increase the dowry unless Malik sahab disagrees with me. क्यों मालिक साहब, हक मेहर बढ़ाया जा सकता कि नहीं? हक मेहर, हाँ, सी, दैट्स द बेस्ट वे टू डू इट.
एंड डू वुड सच इंक्रीज इन द डाउर बी पेबल इन द लाइफ टाइम ऑफ द मैन?
ऑफ कोर्स. सो यू कांट ईट योर केक एंड हैव इट.
इफ पार्ट ऑफ इट रिमेंस अनपेड, वुड दैट बी कंसीडर्ड एज हिज डेट एट द
टाइम?
If a part of the dowry remains unpaid at the time of the death of the man, would that
be... It won't be a part of the inheritance.
So it would be
It will be first paid as a loan, as a due to her, and after the subtraction of the dues from the property left over, the rest would be distributed to the inheritors.
Another question, sir, connected with it. This is practiced quite largely in Bengal, and very often, I regret to say, to defeat the Islamic law of inheritance. In their own lifetime, people who are wealthy create a trust and they appoint their favorite son as a mutawalli. Would it be permissible to have such a trust and appoint a mutawalli, so one's wife as a mutawalli?
If the purpose is to defeat Islamic law, then it is not permissible here or there. Even in the first instance, it becomes not permissible. But if it is to promote the spirit of Islamic law and remaining within the four walls, not rebelling against some positive instructions, but making use of the cushions provided, one does not defeat the purpose, but promotes the purpose of law. That is permissible.
So have I understood you correctly, that if one remains within the framework laid down by Islam,
exactly,
then it would be permissible to form a trust and make your wife in
order? If it is, it does not defeat the spirit.
I understand.
That's right. That is permissible.